Hi Ivan, how are you doing? It's my first stream, so don't be too hard on me. If you have any questions about software engineering in general, feel free to ask. Yeah, I'm doing quite good. It's a bit late here, but anyways, it's quite okay. Are you even interested in the Kotlin part, or are you just here because of the questions? Because for now, I don't mind just talking or just coding some bit. So, whatever you like. That's not bad. What's your previous programming experience so far? Are you more the JavaScript guy or anything else? But are you new to JavaScript or do you have a job as a developer? I mean, I could start anyway. Just maybe you can then learn some Kotlin on the fly. I think if you already have some programming experience, it would be just fine. I mean, in the last few parts of the tutorials, I introduced a lot of constructs which are pretty similar to JavaScripts. What I want to build now is a rock, paper, scissor game. With my whole Kotlin setup here, we don't have much user input. It's mostly console input. Ah, cool, as what? It's just a front-end dev. For how long? But coming back to, let me just continue here. Oh, that's awesome. I think I am on my third year right now. So it's pretty similar. What do you like the most about your job? And also, are you familiar with this rock, paper, scissor game? I played it a lot as a kid, I guess. And even if it's only for settling some decisions. Hi Aiden, I hope I pronounced it correctly. That's a quite quite good part of coding in general. It's well paid and you don't have to do much when it comes to physical stuff. I mean, my brother is working as somebody who's constructing cars, and it's a pretty tough job. It's like 40 hours and you have to be lifting parts and everything. But maybe we can start a bit with the Kotlin part here. I hope everybody is familiar with rock, paper, scissors. I mean, the rules are pretty solid. Rock crushes scissors, scissors cuts paper, and paper covers rock. And if you have the same thing. Thanks. It will result in a draw. That's at least good if everybody's aware of it. Teach me to play, yeah. Maybe go back to the rules just a bit. You've never seen this? Thomas, come on. Don't make me weak. How much? I know. Let's get back to it. So, what we need to do to fulfill this thing? We have a lot of user input. At first, he can choose either he for himself wants to have rock, paper, or scissors. And afterwards, he will be notified what the computer had chosen and what the final result was. The game will be over as soon as a best of 10 winner is determined. This means if one of the players has won more than 6 rounds. So let's start with this part where the user can enter his choice. First here, start with the main function. This is really like Java if you have ever written it, but here it's basically as soon as you have this, you can execute this. No, somehow. Somehow it seems I fucked up the config here. I cannot select it. Nice. Maybe start with a new project then. It's easier to figure it out later on. Let's make it a new project. That's quite okay. So let's try it again. Finally, this will get executed. Can we run it now? Yeah, okay. Looks better. Hooray. So let's start with the main function and we want to get some user input in. If you have any questions, just use the chat. I will hopefully answer them. Keyword in Kotlin for variables is R, which is something that you can change later on. Or you have a value, which is val, which means this thing can only get changed once. So let's get the user input. In Kotlin, you can use readline, which is quite handy. It will, I can show you, it will prompt you just for a line of user input. You can enter whatever you want, and then it will save it in the variable here. Even I actually do, yes. We use it as, I would say, a drop-in replacement for Java most of the time. I'm not an Android dev, but I guess for Android developers it's even more common nowadays. If I do too many mistakes, just blame it on the stage fright here. I'm not used to code while talking that much. Let's say or empty. One of the cool things about Kotlin is actually, if you're not used to it, it has built-in nullability checks. So if I remove this here, what Kotlin is saying by this adjustment here, hey, this could be a string or null, actually. At work, I do different things, yes. In the past, I wrote a backend for an Android and iOS app, but there we did in fact use Java. And now on the new project, we basically use the same framework, Spring. So we're writing Spring Boot services, and most of them are now using Kotlin. For what kind of an app? The last app I worked on was an app to control your vehicle. So you could check your mileage and different things. Yeah, it was a native mobile app on Android and iOS. Let's print something. Just give the user some instructions. Let's say choose. Could we do choose? Rock, paper, or skisses. This will just print the text here. Then we will just save it in a variable. Let's call it user choice, maybe. And just to give you something what we can look at, let's say just print it back. So now we can say, hey, whatever we want, and we'll print it again. Okay. I will not build too much validation in this project, just continue to work on it, and then later we can build some validation if needed. I want to continue with the computer choice. Let's name it enemy choice. And oh, maybe make it back. I want to use random and say next int. And because we have three choices, we can say from 0 to 3. And we also want to store it in a variable. Enemy choice. And it will have the number. But actually, in the next few lines, I don't want to deal with this number anymore. I want also to have these characters. So what can we do here? I would say we can use a when. And then just map it and say, hey, terms of 0, let's make it an R. When it's a 1, make the P. And if it's a 2, make it an S. And probably it's complaining now that we're missing the S branch. That's okay. Yeah, this should never happen. Just leave it for now like this. So let's try to debug it a bit and just remove this user choice. And now here we will print user choice was $userChoice and enemy choice was $enemyChoice. If we run this again, what will happen? We can put in something. For now we can put whatever we want. And it's saying user choice put whatever we want and enemy choice was error. In Kotlin we also have enum classes. Enum classes are like a subset. We could make an enum class called choice here. And what kind of choices do we have? Make it rock, paper, scissors. Just hoping I get the syntax right. Wrong braces, I guess. Yeah. Like this. So the good thing here is now we can say instead of this error, and we always need to compare with the string, it's not good. We can here say instead choice or directly rock, probably. See if we can import it like this. The benefit here is we have code completion and also it's easy to compare them. Makes the code much cleaner. So we could do the same thing now for the user choice. Let's maybe just copy it, most of it. Just say, hey, user choice we can read the line here and just say when read line or empty, what's it saying? Oh well. Of course now it's not numbers, it's what the error is. But strings. Yeah, you should copy everything, then it works better, yeah. And now it's importing the wrong choice, nice. So we could import them even like this. And let's make the default one a rock so we get a proper choice back. Alright, so now we have the user choice choice and the enemy choice also is a choice. And here we see, maybe we'll just use the default as rock. Or we can make even an undefined, which we could use here and there. All right. So if we run this, then we see that the user choice was rock and enemy choice was paper, so we perfectly mapped it and can use this enum later on. So let's continue building it. So we have the user endpoint, the user input, and the enemy choice. So what else do we need? We could construct an outcome. And I probably also want to make an enum for it. Let's call it outcome, and an outcome could be a win, a draw, and a loss. Say outcome when the enemy choice is equal to the user choice, what will it be? It will be a draw. Okay. Another possibility is, let's figure out all cases with the user would win. So this would be for one thing, it would be if enemy choice is, let's say rock. Thanks, Ivan. I will just continue the code here a bit. Thanks for watching. And the user choice equals to paper. I hope this is correct. Thanks for the subscription. So this would be one case. Just leave it like this. Think more about the logic, the outcome should be, let's think about it. So enemy choose rock and we hit paper, so we win. So let's add multiple of these and think about any condition. So rock, paper, skizzes, and we need to determine all the wins. So let's say rock versus paper would win. Maybe we should, I don't like it that all. Let's make it the other way around and say user choice is this and enemy choice like that. Much better. So when we have a paper and the enemy has a rock, we win. All right. If we have a rock and the enemy then must have a skisser so that we win. Rock, paper, skisser. Maybe just make it like that. Rock, paper, skisser. And for a skisser to win, we need the enemy to have paper. So the outcome will be a win. And in all other cases, what should happen? The outcome should be a loss. So we have covered draws and the user to win and a loss. Now continue to write a text here, dot, and let's say the outcome was a outcome. And let's try it. Let's choose rock. We choose rock. Enemy choice was paper. The outcome was a loss. That's already correct. So let's think about, sadly I closed the readme here. Let's see if I can find it somewhere in a browser. So what do we have? We said user can enter his choice, rock, paper, scissors. The user will be notified what the computer had chosen. We already have that. The user will be notified what the outcome of the duel was. Yeah, and this is also finished. Now the last thing we need to finish this thing here is that the game will continue to play until a winner in a best of 10 is determined. So we need some kind of while loop around it. And maybe some better printing of all of it. But let's see. So one thing I like to do is, if you have now, this method is getting pretty big, we will refactor it later so that we don't have to scroll that much. But let's see, can IntelliJ do this somehow? I want to surround this a bit. Work pretty well. Ah, you know what, I do it by hand. So we want to have a while loop. Just move this at the end. So we could make it while true. This would mean that this will run until the end of time. Rock, rock, rock. This is already good, but we want to have it finish after a while, right? So we need a condition for this. I would say we could say, we need a variable for the user wins. Initialize it to zero. We need a variable for the computer wins. Oh, let's say it, how did we name it here? Enemy wins. And maybe we want to count also the draws. And now we could say, what did we read just now? It was that the condition is that one of them has more than six. But in order for a best of 10, it means if the sum of all games would be 10. So we could say if user wins plus computer wins, let's don't call enemy wins. As long as it's smaller than 10, and I think we need another condition, so in case it's 5-5. Let's say, and user wins. Let's think about the condition for a moment. So either if this is lower, or the user wins are equal to the enemy wins. So let's think about it. This will run as long as they are both together below 10, and also when they are equal. So this is like this catch, if it's like 5 versus 5 or so. But now when we run this, what will happen? It will work for sure, but it will never ever end because we not increase these values anywhere. Let's see, where is this outcome method? Let's just say, hey, draw plus plus. Is this draw? Here we have a user win plus plus, and here we have enemy wins plus plus. I think this should be already sufficient here. Let's think about it. That looks good. Let's run it again. We will choose all the time a rock. Maybe if I want to print out the current score, maybe. At least at the end, we want to print something. Let's say print, game is over. Final score was 2 user wins versus computer. Was it enemy wins? And dollar draws. Hey Abdullah, how you doing? Do you mean by blur is the quality kind of low or? Maybe I need to look into it. I will have a look after this stream, sorry then. But I thought it must be okay. Where are we at? I think this thing is almost finished with this rock paper scissor thing, but space, maybe if you want, you can still have some questions or so. I can give you a quick recap. Just when I'm finished with it. So we now can play against the computer here. Kind of cool to see the maintainers of it, or I think you're some kind of what is this role called of yours? I guess it's developer relationships or something. Ah, advocate, okay. So, back at it. Abdullah, I wanted to answer your question about what a backend engineer does. I think it's mostly about designing services and APIs for frontends to consume. If you have, for example, a to-do app, I mean, the front end will not keep the state of the user's to-do items. This need to be stored in some kind of database, and this happens on the backend side. So a lot of times it's really gathering requirements together with designing APIs together with front-end people. And not all of it, it's also, I would say, most of the time nowadays it also is about running the application somewhere. So if something goes down or is not performing well, you have to look at it. I think if you're in for the buzzwords, it is DevOps. With DBA, I guess you need database analyst. I think it's not just about databases. This was just an example. So often it could be also just transforming data when you have another API you call from your side. Let's say you integrate something like the GitHub API or all the other APIs that are out there, then you could really just transform the data. You don't need a database. I mean, most of the times you could do most of it also on the front end, but you shouldn't do it because of security reasons. I think it depends where you work or, but I'm pretty satisfied with the pay. Yeah, and performance reasons. But it depends since nowadays the user devices are pretty strong, to be honest. If you think about the latest iPhones, they're probably faster than a computer 10 years ago or 15. Or at least similar. Yeah, that's right. Where are the best dev jobs in Europe? I think Spacey could tell you where JetBrains is. But actually, I heard Switzerland is really competitive about pay. But I don't have any clue how the health system works there, to be honest. I get a lot of recruiter mails, also from Switzerland, and the pay gap is really real. Space Abbey, is it? I thought JetBrains, but it's not only Munich, right? It's where's JetBrains from? Yeah, Abdullah, I think everything is really expensive there. Really, really expensive, at least for my German feelings. I mean, the Swiss people come over here and they shop like kings. Yeah, I remember Prague the most, I guess, maybe. That's why I was a bit confused, but I was not aware that you're also in Munich. Interesting. So let's continue a bit playing here. I should really add a score. This is kind of you losing the overview. Sebi, do you know by any chance in which language IntelliJ is written? As idea? Huh. What a nice example, huh? But actually, I think you can't go wrong with Kotlin. But in the backend world, it would be quite interesting, I guess. Once Java 14 is there, I think it's pretty competitive. And because basically Java is the JVM, a lot of these things are getting pretty much optimized there. I think where Kotlin really shines is on the Android side, since everything is Java 1.8 there, and then you can have all the nice things without upgrading the major version of Java. Because let's face the truth, I guess Android will never ever upgrade to Java 11 on you. Or at least they will upgrade, but I guess they will not manage to get critical mass. Because I'm almost finished, let's say user choice was this, and also print some current score here. Just make it user. Think this will help a bit. Sebi, are you hiring remotely? So for remote people, by any chance? It's pretty crazy with this whole COVID stuff. Yeah, I guess even the local people are now working remotely, probably. Let's choose a few times rock. Oh god, I'm losing light. Right bit here. Paper, paper. Rock, paper. Oh God. What a coincidence. Always draws. Fourteen draws. Oh my God. Sebi, what is your definition of a senior? Abdullah, that's a good question. Actually, I was thinking about this a lot since I wanted to create this course about Kotlin. And my background is a bit more academic. But this isn't something I would suggest to somebody who wants to break in pretty quickly. Yeah, internships sound great. I think it should go together with you learning a bit on the side, since in the beginning it's pretty harsh, I would say. But it's getting better over time. You don't need. I think it should be. It will be really time-consuming in the beginning. And for getting that internship, I guess it should depend what you want to do, actually. I think web development could be a good start, but could be quite competitive, I'm not sure. Abdullah, I'm also quite happy that I don't have to learn it myself since I'm a native speaker. I think if somebody is learning German as a second language and learning his grammar is pretty good, then he will probably be better than all of the Germans. The fun thing is, in German schools, you also learn German, the grammar, and this is really hard even for German people. Abdullah, the thing is, in German, you can connect as many words as you want in the language. I think it's just how is it in English. I mean, yeah, you can. Yeah, CP, thanks. This is like a word connection mechanism. See, in this in English, it would be something like a word connection. And it's why you get in German these long words. Yeah, I also have an Indian colleague at work, and also in my previous team, I had an Indian colleague at work, and also one woman from South Korea, and they had a pretty hard time learning German. So for a long time, we had even English as our first language in the team, despite I think 5 of the 7 people were in fact Germans. Also not pretty correct, but for them their first language was German. But since then it's a while, and I think I lost a lot of English already. Sebi, how is this stream for you looking, by the way? Okay, cool. I mean, it should be full HD at least, and yeah. Sebi, do you have a LinkedIn, by the way? I'm not even sure. Maybe we are even already connected there. If you don't mind. But I guess that's in your role, I guess you're pretty much connected to all the developers where you can. Yeah, Abdullah, I'm not sure if YouTube is right now defaulting to low resolutions because of this corona crisis. I remember. Yeah, but at least I learned that you're also quite active in the Munich area. Have you been a dev for a long time? I would say yes. But actually, in the industry I'm for, I guess, I would say 5 to 6 years if you count like that. I mean, my intro to computers was with, I would say, copying games from computer magazines, which is quite good because you learn a lot of stuff to modify it a bit and here and there, and you learn a lot about syntax. And later on, I did an apprenticeship for 3 years, and then afterwards starting to get my university degrees. And since then, I think on my fifth year now on the job. But like I said, I think even if you want to skip all of this, I think you can learn it on your own. Especially like CB suggested here. Try to build something if you're interested, then it should be not that hard to get an internship somewhere. And the good thing is if you have an internship, you see if it's for you. I had a lot of people on my journey where they realized later on it was not for them. Most of them pretty late, which is kind of a bad thing. The only thing I cannot really grasp right now is I have a feeling if you're like building furniture or something, I think after like, I don't know, 10 years you have seen everything. But maybe I'm naive there. But I guess you have your room of expertise and you're done. I mean, I'm not sure if there will be new ways of working with wood or anything, but I guess you can just go from house to house and use your skills there. I think in programming it's quite different. I think there's every year something new. You can learn all the time, and you have even to be okay with not knowing anything, everything, I mean. If I think about it, I think even if I'm coding now for 8 years, probably a junior front-end dev will run circles around me when it comes to CSS. I mean, a lot of people claim to be full stack by, but yeah, I think that's not so possible. Nah, it's not hard picking up new stuff, but it's more like there's always new things to learn. I mean, what I meant earlier is if you're maybe a manager. Then you don't have to think about picking up new things that much. If you're a developer, you're every year you're learning something new. I mean, it's also interesting, but this is something you have to deal with. If I remember the times from, I would say 2010 to 2016, the front-end world was really hard because to me it felt like there was every 3 months a new framework. And you definitely need some time to get good with this stuff. I mean, if I would not write the same thing in Python or something, I think it will not be an issue. Just for more difficult things, I think there's some skill gap I have at the beginning. Like best practices, how to do this in Python, and there will be a lot of Googling involved then. Which is not a bad thing by any means, but it's just not as productive to stay with the same language or same frameworks. And if you are in it for a while, yeah. You got family, you got your free time. Some people don't want to work outside of work, and some jobs don't give you the room to keep yourself up to date. I mean, what I look in jobs nowadays is if you have opportunities to learn something new. Because if you don't learn this on the job, yeah, where would you learn it? And always chasing the new things is pretty stressful. If you do it for years at least. Oops, sorry. But guys, thanks for your time. I guess I'm going to go offline in a few minutes. Do you have any further question, Abdullah or Sibi? Yeah, thanks to both of you. I think it would have been a bit lonely without you. Yeah, Sibi, no issue. Really no issue. I'm trying to get the hang of all of it. And I guess I was. It was not the most interesting stream anyway. But I think it will get better over time at least. So take care, both of you. Bye bye. Good night, yeah.